Good evening and welcome to Queeries. I'm Brian, your host, and with me I have Joey Luthman. Pronounced that correctly, yes?
That's perfect,
awesome.
Yes.
And some of you may recognize him from a television show that you did here on DATV
years and years ago. Yeah.
Like yesterday for me in terms of years, but you know what
happened. Yeah.
You are now out in California and you're pursuing an acting career. So,
yes.
First of all, why don't we just, let's go back to the beginning, shall we? What got you interested in, number one, having a DATV public access show along with your sister? And what was it, for those that don't really remember or know?
Yeah. No, but I had a show on DATV called The Joey and Elise Show. Mm-hmm. Pretty self-explanatory. Mm-hmm. I'm Joey. My sister is Elise.
Right.
And, we actually started it on like a web series kind of thing. I can't remember. Exactly. There was a couple different streaming sites that we would put our show onto. And the idea was we had a lot of friends that were actors out in Los Angeles that we would have on Skype, or we'd have other people, you know, sometimes all over the world. We interviewed one guy who was an actor in Taipei City, Taiwan, I think is the name of the, so all over the place. Mm-hmm. But the idea was, you know, we're bringing Los Angeles to Dayton, Ohio.
Right.
And then when we discovered DATV, we thought it was a perfect transition to up the quality from web show to full-blown TV production kind of thing. So that was fun. We did that for a while here, actually. And I think that was, 8 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It was a lot of fun, though. So it was actually, we learned so much. There was a lot about the behind the scenes that we learned, about the filmmaking process, about broadcasting and about hosting and knowing lines and cue cards and everything's live, and it's very stressful but also exciting at the same time.
Right.
So it was a great experience.
Excellent. As you know, your show wore on, you eventually decided that you wanted to, you know, take this further. Was this you and Elise, did you kind of push your parents into, hey, this is what we want to do kind of thing? Or did they push you? Or was it just sort of fell out of the sky?
Well, I mean, it was kind of, we actually were in Los Angeles for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we came back here, while we were here for like a year and a half or so, that's when we did DATV.
Mm-hmm.
So it was sort of just like a break in a way. Mm-hmm. And then we went back.
Gotcha.
But it was, we love acting, you know, me and my sister. And Elise actually got into acting more so around that time, when we went back. I think it was 2011, she's actually very successful. She's in a lot of ways now more successful than I am. She's she's working all the time on Lifetime and Hallmark, and we haven't worked together yet, which is surprising.
Hmm.
Being brother and sister, you'd think that would be
a thing
that people would want to do, but. We haven't worked together, so that's still a goal that we have to achieve.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Are both of you focused? You mentioned Elise is actually, you know, doing Hallmark and, you know, Lifetime, which I'm assuming, you know, the movies on those channels as far as that goes. Is your goal to remain solely on TV? Are both of you looking to hit the big screen and all of that? Or
it's kind of the goal, you know, to hit the big, you know, the big silver screen, you know, all that stuff. But honestly fortunate about, you know, anything that I get to do. I don't take anything for granted anymore. I think I sort of did that when I was younger, because I didn't really understand how fortunate I was to get as many roles as I got at such a young age. You know, everyone would tell me, oh, your resume is so impressive. And it was just something that I'd hear all the time. And I never really thought about what that meant, how really cool that is. So now I totally understand how cool that is. And I love... There's something so special about TV. I love TV and how fast it moves and the pacing, the energy of everyone on set. And everyone I've worked with is extremely nice. Everyone I've worked with is amazing and humble and also very amazing actors. But I love film as well. You know, I'm kind of like all over the place with that in that regard. I'm not really, you know, I don't want to settle down on one thing because, you know, It's all fun. It's all great. It's all what I love to do.
Well, and I would imagine too, you know, in terms of acting, because you see an awful lot of individuals that, you know, let's take George Clooney, for example. You know, TV first.
ER for many years,
And, you know, and then moving on into film. I mean, it was a very successful transition. You see an awful lot of, you know, whether they're TV or, you know, big screen actors, you know, doing Broadway or, you know, doing off-Broadway or something of that nature. Do you have any desire to do any of that?
Absolutely, absolutely. No, I am actually going to be working on a play later this summer. But it's no, I love all that kind of stuff. You know, I never felt like I was. Well, I mean, I started in theater. I started in theater and musicals and stuff, and I loved that because I also got to do it with my brothers and sisters. So I was sort of looking up to them and following in their footsteps and. You know, my brother would be Winthrop in Music Man, and I'd follow him around and annoy him and sing all the songs with him. But yeah, no, I love all of that stuff. It's cool because, you know, transitioning from theater to TV and film is a big jump, you know. Your audience is that camera, and that's, you know, that's who you're playing to. So it's a lot more intimate instead of being as broad. But I don't know. I feel like it's natural for me to kind of jump back and forth. So I want to get back into theater a little bit more because I definitely enjoy it.
Oh, that's cool.
It's a fun energy.
So in terms of, you know, obviously one of the things that someone would have to get used to, and one has to get used to it, you know, pretty much anyone in life, but more so in acting, how do you deal or how did you deal with rejection? You know, where it's like, you know, hey, you were great.
No, it was, it was the kind of thing that if I had started professionally acting now, I think it would be a lot worse on me. But because I started when I was, you know, 9 and 10, and, you know, really, really taking off around like 11 and 12, I think that I didn't really see it so much as rejection. I just saw it as like, I'm just doing an audition. Now I'm doing another audition. Now I'm doing another audition. And I get to work on this one now. So it was kind of like, you know, it was just something I loved to do. And so I never really saw it as like a job or a chore or anything. Or like, you know, my life is depending on this one role. And if I don't get it, then it's all over. You know. But now it's actually, you know, I still, you know, don't take it too personally if I don't get a role or you know, get rejected. But of course now it's, you know, a matter of you know, being independent and making money. You know? So it's there's that aspect of it as well, that as I'm getting older, I'm understanding a little bit better. So but no, it's I don't know. It hurts sometimes if it's a role that I really, really wanted, but I also understand that, you know, there will be another one that will be even better. I just have to wait for it.
Now, in terms of, you know, just being out there, you know, Los Angeles, Hollywood is a completely different universe.
Absolutely.
You know, from Dayton. Have you worked with or met actors and actresses that you have a particular fondness for? You know, did you run into them at Starbucks? I mean, do people trip over stars out there? Kind of thing.
Well, I mean, it's sometimes, you know, it's funny. I watch, you know, I'll watch my, you know, favorite actors or actresses, and they'll be doing like a the vlog or something, and they'll be at a Starbucks on Sunset Boulevard that I was just at, you know, like an hour ago, and things like that is kind of cool, you know. But yeah, I don't run into them too often, but I do get to work with some really cool people. I was just on a show on National Geographic. It was it was their second scripted show. Their first scripted show is Genius, and so they are. This is their second one, and I think they're. I mean, I'm sure they're making more. But this was called The Long Road Home. It was about the war in Iraq in 2004, and I got to work with a guy that I listened to his voice, and of course, I'm a big fan of his dad, Jason Ritter.
And he tried to save Chen. You understand? Then we have to work together. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Cool guy. They're really cool guys too. Right. Jason is such a nerd. I mean, we were playing board games and stuff, and you know, Settlers of Catan, the board game. I mean, he really gets into that. Let me tell you, it's so fun. Those were really cool.
I think the interesting thing is that you know, for those of us you know that are not you know, we're not in that world. You know, I mean, it's I find it very interesting that just how we view actors and actresses that we're familiar with, number one, as being somehow superhuman and sort of above, you know, the rest of us mere plebeians down below here. And then we find out, you know, that they're just regular people, you know, kind of thing. And it's like, well, that doesn't really mesh with what I thought.
I know. That's true. No, it's funny. I think about that a lot, you know, like we just pick people. The general public just sort of picks people that they think looks great on camera and can act really well. And they're like, they're now my favorite person ever. And we're going to make them really popular just because we love them so much and we want them to work. So it's funny, you know, we create this image for actors. And they're just random people that have a natural gift for it. But it's, you meet all kinds. Like I know... what's his name? Vin Diesel likes to play D&D. I mean, like, you know,
you would never imagine
this big buff Vin Diesel sitting there like being a warlock. You know what I mean? Like, it's pretty great. But they're regular people that do regular things and sometimes nerdy and sometimes things you wouldn't expect. But they also happen to be big movie stars.
Well, I think one reason I feel very sorry for, you know, actors and actresses is that, you know, once you reach a particular point, fans almost think that they own you and that, you know, guess what? I see you in the grocery store and I'm just going to, you know, invade your personal space and I'm I'm going to make a commentary on, my God, they got ground chuck instead of, you know, ground turkey. My God, what's wrong with this?
But, I know.
I mean, have you run into any of that where... Not, I mean, not on the level of like, you know, like a George Clooney or something.
Oh, for sure. Not too bad. I mean, I honestly don't mind too much. But again, I haven't, you know, I'm not on that level. If, you know, if I was like a Tom Cruise kind of thing, you know, then I'd be a lot more heightened as far as that goes. You know, fans stopping all the time. And it's, you know, it's kind of the thing where you know, an actor's dream, they're like, oh, wow, I just wish I could have people stopping me. Oh, no, please, no pictures.
Please.
You know, but what a troubled life, you know. But, you know, it's, I get it. I get it. You know, it's kind of the kind of thing where it's hard to complain about, you know, if that does happen to you, because people say, oh, wow, you know, that's so terrible to be wanted so much. But, you know, your privacy isn't as much as, you know, you take it for granted, I guess, if you, you know, you forget about what kind of privacy you had beforehand. And it's, it's a little weird, you know, it's a different subculture of sort of people looking up to other people. It's really cool. I mean, it is really cool to have fans that are really devoted to specific people because of shows that they watch, you know, but... Yeah, some fans can take it too far.
See, I totally missed my boat. You just, you know, I should have parlayed my Wheel of Fortune episode that I was actually on in in 96. Had I just known, I could have parlayed that into a reality television.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, maybe this is what I've... Here's Wheel of Fortune.
There's so much reality TV that, it would be a huge hit.
This is the hand that shook Pat Sajak's hand. Hey. Not once, but twice.
Wow. So, calm amazing. Down. Yeah. You're all over the place.
Oh, my God. Yeah, please, no pictures. But now, in terms of kind of where you're headed, what do you have... I also know that, you know, you kind of have to, you can't necessarily like spill the beans about everything that you're doing, that
for
kind
sure,
of thing.
For sure.
Do you have any projects that you're currently working on or that have been worked on and they're just, you know, they're in editing right now and they're imminently being released?
Yeah. Well, there's actually a project. It's a feature film. It's called The Last Champion, and it's a wrestling film, and I play a wrestler. Mm-hmm. Basically, it stars Cole Hauser, and Glenn Withrow was our director and co-writer, along Hallie Todd, who was on Lizzie McGuire, the mom on Lizzie McGuire. Amazing, wonderful people. Mm-hmm. And basically, it's about Cole Hauser's character. It was a he was an Olympic wrestler, and he comes from this really small town. Basically, the town hates him because he got kicked out of the Olympics for using steroids. Mm-hmm. And so it's such a small town, everyone talks.
Right.
And he comes back to town, and basically some family things are going on, and that's why he comes back. And he ends up teaching the wrestling team at the high school there, and that's basically where I come in. I'm a wrestler in that high school team, and it was really fun. I actually got to train a little bit for that.
Oh, really?
Alongside some other guys who were actual wrestlers and still are wrestling. Mm-hmm. So it was intimidating to say the least. I was wrestling. It wasn't quite in the same weight class. It was actually pretty funny. I'm in the... just by looking at me, I'm in like the 105 weight class, and I was training with these guys that were in like the 185 weight class. So it was
a little bit of a disparity there.
Kind of like the Babe Ruth bat with three and then bat with one kind of thing. It was just kind of a good way to practice. It was great. It was a lot of fun. Very intense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, that's now. Another thing that, I think is kind of, interesting, or something that I wonder about, at what, there are some people that, it's almost like they take on the characteristics of their characters, that somehow they've morphed their personality into this.
Yeah.
So how does one remain grounded? So that way, obviously you want to grow as a human being, you want to grow, grow as a person, kind of thing, but how do you make sure that you're still grounded enough that you're you, you just happen to be playing someone else for, a little bit of time?
I'd say that it's kind of, it's fairly easy to stay grounded for me, because I put, parts of myself and my experiences into every role that I do. Mm-hmm. So it keeps it grounded automatically. Sometimes there are roles that are very different from me and very different from any experience, and I have to kind of just imagine what it would be like, sort of using some of my experiences and then using the what if technique of, what if I was in this situation.
Right.
And then it becomes you're really diving into a specific mindset. I wasn't shooting anything, but I was doing it for a class, and I was, we do techniques where, we go on task, basically. Mm-hmm. Basically getting method for like a week, where we really dive into the character and really do research, and basically are acting as the character as much as we can within that week of studying.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fascinating, because that was the first time that, and I don't remember the role that I was doing for that, but I remembered that we finished the scene and it was done.
Mm-hmm.
And I remembered it was I was playing this really creep, like, psycho killer, and it was for like a second after the scene was done that I was still kind of in it, and then I came out of it. It was it was weird because you were in it for like a whole week.
Right.
And
but let's just make a point that you weren't, you did not kill
anyone. I was not actually a killer, no. I didn't go that method with it, yeah. I imagined, you know.
Right.
But no, but it was weird. It was kind of like, in that moment, I got it. I got how actors can sometimes really fall into sort of that, it takes a little bit to get out of the character kind of thing, where, yeah, you know, like a Daniel Day-Lewis who takes like a year to get into character, and then he takes several months to actually come back to real life, you know, because you've been this person for so long. And so, but no, for the most part, I stay grounded. I put myself into it, and it keeps it real, and it keeps it natural, and it kind of keeps it grounded. And it's, you were saying, growing as a person and as an actor, it's kind of interesting. It changes, it goes back and forth. Sometimes I'll realize, you know, I've grown as a person, and I'll apply that to my role in acting.
Sure.
And sometimes I'll realize that I've learned a lot of things about the character that then makes me learn stuff about myself in person. And so it's kind of cool. You know, it's life imitating art, imitating the life. It's, you know, it's all a cool cycle of life there.
Oh, no, that's, no, I mean, it makes perfect sense. I mean, honestly speaking, you know, I think that everyday people do that. I mean, most people would never know that I am an introvert.
Yeah.
I'm very
introverted. I'm very much introverted as well. Yeah. I love to express myself. I feel like, you know, sometimes if I have a really cool thing to say, I'm going to explode if I can't tell anybody about it.
Right.
But I'm very much, you know, introverted as well.
Yeah. It's like, you know, so, and it's one of those things where you get to play a role. I mean, you know, for me, you know, I used to teach.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, an introvert teaching people, you have to be, you kind of need to be extroverted in order to teach.
Yeah.
So the way I approach this, you know, where I'm like a faux journalist of sorts, that, you know, again, it's the role I get to play.
Very cool.
You know, and then I go home and curl up in bed and cry a little.
So I totally get that. That's me. I'm a crazy gamer, so that's kind of like what I do. When I'm not acting, I'm at home chatting it up with my friends, and I'm gaming.
Yep.
That's me. It's 24/7.
I'm pretty boring. I just read.
I love reading, too.
Yeah.
I love reading.
Yeah, I'm not much of a gamer,
I'm a big sci-fi reader, too.
Yeah. Oh, sci-fi, wonderful genre.
Yeah.
Absolutely love it. Star Trek or Star Wars?
You know, I'm going to lean towards Star Wars, but I love Star Trek. I love Star Trek so much.
Yeah, I'm a Trekkie. I'm a big time Trekkie.
Yeah, my family as well. They got me into Star Trek. Yeah.
Or the original?
The original, yeah. And I think my favorite is Next Generation, but but the original is fantastic. Yeah.
God, I grew up watching The Next Generation.
Yeah.
I was in junior high and high school.
Yeah, there you
when
go.
When it came out.
And, my mom as well.
A billion years ago. And, you know, high school and college and everything. And
about the time you'd be able to look out your window, see a Tyrannosaurus Rex walking by your window, you know?
Yeah, exactly. You know, Velociraptor, whatever. Now, I guess to kind of wrap things up, what advice would you give to... think back to when you were young. Well, I'm looking at you and you're
younger,
kind of thing. What advice would you give someone like you who might have an acting bug that bites them? What should they do?
I would say that, you know, it takes a lot of guts to do it in the first place. Mm-hmm. It takes a lot of guts in the first place to stand up on a stage and give a speech to, you know, hundreds of people, and that's stressful.
Mm-hmm.
Let alone, it's seemingly, which is funny, more stressful to do all of that in front of a little camera, and you've got maybe three people around it, and one person on the lights or something, and one person doing sound, and it's so much more intimate and intense, and everything you do is micromanaged, but it's. It takes a lot of guts, and I would say if it's something you really feel passionate about, you know, you can't be doing this anymore. You can't not do it. You got to do it. You got to be out there and doing that. It's your passion. I would say really go for it. And mm-hmm. it's, yes, there's a lot of rejection. There's a lot to think about as far as, you know, what you look like and, you know, like really perfecting a natural sounding and doing scenes and stuff with mm-hmm. someone else and a lot of different things to think about. But if it's really something you're passionate about, you're going to work for it.
Mm-hmm.
And
sure.
so that's what I would say is persistence. Mm-hmm. It's easier said than done.
Sure.
But definitely as best you can be persistent and stick with it.
Mm-hmm. And I would also imagine be open to
absolutely.
You know, if you're rejected,
be open to criticism, helpful, yeah. constructive criticism.
Right.
It's something that I try to keep myself open because I was so open when I was younger.
Sure.
And now, you know, I get so in my head about it, and I feel like, you know, I know everything. And
right.
so then when I get criticism, I'm like, no, I mm-hmm. know how to do it.
Right.
But there's still always something you can learn. I mean, I've gone to a coach for years
mm-hmm.
and for acting, and he said that he coached Sylvester Stallone not too long ago. I know, right? Not too long ago.
Sure.
I mean, it's you know, you don't think about it, but yeah, these huge big actors, they still need to learn stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They still have stuff they can learn and grow, and that's what's really cool about it is you'll never stop growing.
Right.
And it's just a matter of accepting it
mm-hmm.
and taking it in.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. All right, Joey Luthman, thank you for being on the show and gracing us with your presence.
Thank you very much.
We can
much.
Say we know you when or something.
Absolutely, yeah.
as far
Thanks
as that goes.
Me.
And wishing you the absolute best of luck as you know, continue on your acting career. And I'm sure we'll see you in plenty of stuff moving forward.
Hopefully.
So thank you for being on the show, and thank you for watching. And we look forward to seeing you next week. I saw the sun for the first time.